राम राम हरे हरे, हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा 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 हरे हरे। सो ओके डिवोटीज, वी कैन गेट स्टार्टेड इफ यू ऑल आर ओके। इज दैट फाइन? So Lakshmi Mataji, you will be given the co-host permission to share the screen. And so whenever I want you to share the screen, you can share the screen, Lakshmi Mataji, if that's okay.
Yes, Mataji, I'm ready.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Is the Prabhu there? I mean, one Prabhu also joins, right? Do we need to wait for him?
I think Prabhu is joined. Venkat Prabhu, I'm not sure.
Yes, Mataji.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. All right. So first of all, I want to extend my thanks to Lalitangi Mataji and Sukhasagari Mataji for giving me this opportunity to speak on Bhagavad Gita by Srila Prabhupada. So I'm immensely grateful for their association, for helping me, to be associated with you all. So it's a pleasure. And thank you, Matajis. So hope I'm able to deliver to my best and be able to transform the hearts of devotees and myself. So whatever instructions that I'm sharing with you, devotees, it is first meant for me and for my purification, and then it applies to you. So it's all coming from Krishna, and Krishna is giving us the instructions, and these are the desires of the Lord. So I definitely want to make sure that at the end of the day, our hearts is transformed. And that is the expectation from Krishna as well. So he will be pleased and our Gurujanas will be pleased. So with that motivation, we can get started. Thank you. All right. So first, what I am planning is the structure of the class is going to be such that we are going to discuss the Mahatmya, that is the Gita Mahatmya for the second chapter. We will discuss the meaning for that and the story behind it and what our mood should be before we get started in the second chapter. If that's okay, I will get started with Gita Mahatmya. Is that fine?
Yes, Mataji.
Okay, great. So now we see that Lord Vishnu is talking to Mahalakshmi and he says, "My dear Lakshmi, you have heard from me the glories of the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita. And now listen carefully as I tell you the glories of the second chapter." So now we are going to say the story. And kids, if you're on, can you please turn on your videos? I'm kind of blind here. I don't have anybody to see or talk to. So it would be appreciated if anybody who's just not outside or who's available to turn their videos on, they can definitely turn it on. That way it would be an interactive session. And of course, we know Bhagavad Gita is really a philosophical subject matter. And that is why a lot of interaction is needed so we understand this philosophy. Otherwise, it would get boring and it will just be a monologue. All right. So thank you, Riya, for turning on your video. I totally appreciate it. And any more kids who've joined, I mean, I'm totally happy to have your interaction with you as well. So please turn on your videos. Thank you. All right. So we will see the story now. It's going to be an interesting story. So there was once in south, in the town of Pandharpur, a learned Brahmin by the name Devashyama lived. He was able to perform all kinds of sacrifices, that is fire sacrifices. He knew the importance of receiving the guest. So kindly note down what all he's doing, because these are activities like following the regulative principles, that how we follow regulative principles. This person, Devashyama, he's into the Ashtanga Yoga process. And he's able to perform all kinds of fire sacrifices. He knew the importance of receiving the guest. And then by these activities, he managed to satisfy all the demigods. But this person is not performing Ashtanga Yoga. He will come across a person who is performing Ashtanga Yoga. So he is following all these rituals that I'm talking about. Activities such as receiving the guests, activities such as managing and satisfying the demigods. But he was not happy and peaceful in his heart and mind. He had a desire to attain the knowledge of the soul's relationship with the super soul, Paramatma. And towards the end, he would invite the yogis and tapasvis and render all kinds of service to them and inquire from them about the absolute truth. In this way, he passed many years of his life. Okay? And one day, while he was walking, he happened to come across a yogi in front of him, sitting cross-legged with his eyes fixed on the tip of the nose and totally absorbed in meditation. Devashyama could perceive that this yogi was completely peaceful and without any kind of material desires. Devashyama, with the greatest respect and reverence, fell at the feet of this yogi and inquired from him how he could attain such a complete peace of mind. At that time, the yogi, who had the complete knowledge of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna, advised Devashyama to go to this village of Saupur. And there he said, you should meet this guy called Mitravan. And who is he? He was a goat herder by profession, and he takes instructions in the science of God realizations. So you should go and meet this yogi called Mitravan. And from him, you have to take God realization knowledge. So what is the scenario right now? Devashyama, this person, he is performed a lot of austerities. He has invited a lot of tapasvis to his homes. He has performed rituals to the demigods. And he's always inquisitive to know about Atma and Paramatma Gyan. And he comes across this person, Ashtanga Yogi. And he inquired from him how he is able to be so peaceful. Because Devashyama, he was not peaceful at all. So he wanted to know the secret of how a yogi can be peaceful. So now this yogi has instructed him to go and meet Mitravan, who is a goat herder. And of course, looking at the profession, goat herder, right? I mean, from a materialistic view, one may think, oh, how can I take instruction from a goat herder? No, it sounds weird, right? Like this, Devashyama also thought, but he didn't contemplate or he didn't think too much about it. He just went with the decision of going to meet Mitravan and see what he has to say. After hearing this, Devashyama again and again offered his respectful obeisances onto this yogi, and immediately he left to Saupur. When he arrived there, he found on the northern side one beautiful forest where he was informed that Mitravan lived. He inquired from people around and asked, where is this person, Mitravan? Where is he? Where can I find him? When he inquired, he happened to know where Mitravan lived. When he entered the forest, he saw on the bank of a small river, Mitravan was seated on the top of the rocks. Okay, now Mitravan, he looked very beautiful and he was totally peaceful. In that forest, the wind was blowing very gently and a beautiful aroma was emanating from all directions. The goats were peacefully moving here and there, totally unafraid. Some were even sitting next to the tigers and other ferocious animals, but were so peaceful. Can you imagine a scenario where a goat is sitting next to a tiger and so peaceful the atmosphere looks? The tiger is not pounding upon the goat, and the goat is not fearful of the tiger. So everything is so peaceful out there. The atmosphere as such is very peaceful. When Devashyama saw the scene, his mind became very peaceful. He respected and approached Mitravan and sat close to him. Mitravan appeared to be fully absorbed in meditation. After some time, Devashyama, he inquired from him how he would be able to attain such a devotion to Lord Krishna. So once Mitravan happened to complete his meditation, Devashyama, he's inquiring from him, how can I be absorbed in full meditation like you? And how can I attain the devotion of Lord Krishna? Can you please let me know? Like that, Mitravan submissively inquired. When Mitravan heard this question, for a moment, he was lost in deep thought. Okay, what was that thought? When Mitravan heard this question, he was in deep thought. Then he replied, my dear Devashyama, once long ago, I was in this forest looking after these goats when a ferocious tiger happened to attack the goats. At that time, the goats ran here and there to save themselves. I also ran due to the fear of the tiger. From some distance, I looked back and saw that one of the goats was encountered by a tiger on the banks of this river. At that time, a strange and wonderful thing happened. What was that thing? That tiger who was chasing the goat happened to lose all his anger and desire to eat my goat. Thereupon, my goat inquired with the tiger. You have attained your food. So why are you not eating the meat of my body? You should immediately kill me with great relish and eat my flesh. Why are you hesitating so much? Like that, the goat inquired to. The goat asked the tiger. The tiger said, my dear goat, since I have come to this place, all anger has left me and I have no hunger or thirst. The goat said, I also don't know why I am feeling fearless and peaceful. What can be the reason for this? If you know, can you kindly inform me? Like this, the goat asked the tiger. And what happened after that? And now, so they came to Devashyama. They inquired of Devashyama and asked him, do you know the reason why why both of us are feeling this way? Can you please let us know if you know any of those, any reason why this would be the case? And what happened was Mitravan. I'm sorry, I'm confusing the names. I hope you're following along the story. We are talking about Mitravan sharing a story of the tiger and the goat. This Mitravan, he's a goat herder by profession and he's looking after the goats. And one day the tiger happened to pounce upon this goat and the goat ran out of fear. And when they came to a certain spot on the banks of the river, the tiger did not want to eat the goat and nor did the goat feel fearless at that point in time. And now this goat is perplexed at the behavior of the tiger and the tiger is also perplexed by the behavior of the goat. And they inquired Mitravan asking, what is the reason why this is happening? And then Mitravan now goes to a monkey and he inquires this monkey. I noticed the monkey sitting on the branch of a nearby tree. Then I went along with the two of them and inquired from that monkey king. Then the monkey replied to a question with great respect. Okay, the monkey is saying this now. Listen, I will tell you, it's a very old story. In that forest, just in front of you, there is a very large temple in which Lord Brahma installed a Shivalinga. Long ago, a learned sage of name Sukama, who had performed many austerities, lived there. Daily, he would bring lots of flowers from the forest and water from the river and used to worship Lord Shiva. In this way, he was living there for many years when one day a great sage arrived there. At that time, Sukama brought fruits and water and fed to that sage. After the sage had eaten and rested, Sukama spoke to him. O learned one, only for one reason of obtaining Lord Krishna, I'm living here, performing austerities and worship. Because the result of my austerities have been attained today by coming in contact with you, great saint. I am so blessed. I am performing these austerities only for obtaining devotion to Lord Krishna. And as a result of my austerities, I have now come in touch with you. I have now come in contact with a great sage like you. Like that, Mitravan happened to, the Mitravan is now saying the story of Sukama in the forest. Okay, when the sage heard these words of Sukama, which were full of submission, he became greatly pleased. And he said he happened to write it on a stone, the chapter 2 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita. He then instructed Sukama to daily read those verses. And he said, by daily doing so, you will quickly attain your goal. That is, what is your goal? Your goal is to attain devotion to Lord Krishna. And you will soon attain your goal if you daily read this chapter, that is second chapter, which is written on the stone. I'm giving this to you. Now, after having spoken thus, the sage disappeared from that place while Sukama was looking on. And after that, following the instructions of the sage, the Sukama recited those verses for the rest of his life. Very quickly, he attained the complete knowledge of Lord Krishna. And thereby, he started reciting the verses. He felt no more thirst or hunger. Okay. And due to these austerities and devotion, at this place, anyone who visits here, they don't feel the pangs of hunger or thirst. And immediately, that person, whoever comes here, will attain complete peace. Like that, the monkey happened to say the story to Mitravan. So this is the story of the sage. And the sage, he happened to do so many austerities. And he then happened to come in touch with the sage. And the sage happened to, he said he was so, obviously, when someone is submissive, then the sage was very much pleased because of the submission of Sukama. And he happened to tell him, if you happen to recite this verse of second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, you're going to obtain devotion to Lord Krishna. And he gave that stone to him. And this person, he started to follow the instructions of the sage Because of these austerities performing by him, this place became very auspicious. Whoever came there, they don't have any thirst or hunger, or they didn't, what do you say, they always felt peaceful whenever they came to that place. Whoever came to that place, they felt very peaceful there. Okay, and that is what is said so far. And Mitravan said, "My dear Devashyama, after the monkey had finished telling this wonderful story, I, along with the tiger and the goat, went to the temple. We found there written on a piece of stone the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, and I started to recite the sources regularly and daily. In this way, we were able to attain quick devotion to Lord Krishna. So, my dear Brahmin, if you want to start reciting the second verses from second chapter of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, you will also attain the mercy of Lord Krishna." Like this, Lord Vishnu happened to say this to Mother Lakshmi. "My dear Lakshmi, in this way, Devashyama attained knowledge from Mitravan, and after worshipping that great soul, he returned to Pandharpur, and daily he recited the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita. And whoever visited Pandharpur, Devashyama would first have them recite the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita. In this way, Devashyama, he attained the lotus feet of Lord Krishna. My dear Lakshmi, these are the glories of second chapter." So we can very well see how glorious the second chapter is. Whoever is going to recite the slokas and understand the meaning and realize and follow the meanings of the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, they are going to surely attain the lotus feet of Lord Krishna. Because did you note something in this case? So Devashyama, he not only recited it for himself, but he also shared it with others. Whatever knowledge we have, when we share it with the others, the pleasure is doubled to Krishna. He becomes so happy. So whenever we want to, whenever we realize something, we try to share it with others so the others can attain the pleasure of knowing about Krishna, and in turn they get the pleasure themselves also. So this is what is illustrated to the second chapter of Gita Mahatmya. Did you all understand the story? Any questions on the story before we get started with the verses? Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, are you all with me?
Yes, Mataji.
Okay, so any questions so far? Can we get started with our first chapter? I think Gita Mahatmya story was self-explanatory. Hope you all followed that. Can we all move to the first verse of the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita?
Yes, Mataji.
Okay, all right. Thank you so much, Riya. All right, so Lakshmi Mataji, would you mind sharing your screen? We can get started with the first verse.
Yeah, one second, Mataji.
Sure. No problem, Mataji.
Is Gita Mahatya is like another book, Mataji, or
it is from Padma Puran, Prabhu.
Okay.
Padma Purana is talking about Gita Mahatmya. Okay, so before Lakshmi Mataji is doing this, I'll just give you a brief overview before we get started, so you know what's coming up. As we know, the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita is titled Gita Summarized, Contents of the Gita Summarized. So it shows us that the whole Gita is embedded in these verses. So whatever we are going to study in the future, it's all condensed and seen in the second chapter. Okay, so it's very important for us to understand and contemplate upon what Krishna has to say or what Arjuna's questions are. So we would be able to understand the future verses of the chapters, other chapters as well. So this acts as the base. And once we are clear with this chapter, then understanding of the other chapters becomes easy. So here, if you look at the, I think the gist of the chapters, it's 1 to 10th verse talks about Arjuna's further doubts and his surrender, mood of surrender. And then from 11 to 30, So jnana is being talked about. There is a compassion, right? Arjuna was compassionate, and that is why he didn't want to kill the other side. He didn't want to kill the Kauravas because he was compassionate towards them. So Krishna, he's going to counterattack and give some takeaway points for Arjuna and say that soul is eternal, and obviously compassion for the body is ignorant and useless. So this is going to be talked about in the verses 11 to 30. And then if you move on from 30 to 31 to 38, it is going to talk about, so Arjuna, he had, he said, okay, if I'm going to get this kingdom, what am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do with this kingdom? Because there is nobody to enjoy with. Who am I going to enjoy with? So if there is nobody to enjoy with, then what's the point of killing? So I'm not going to kill them. So he gives that as a reason. And then Krishna, he's going to say, by doing your duty, you're going to enjoy. So he's going to talk about karma kanda, especially from 31 to 38. And he say, by doing your prescribed duty, you're going to enjoy. And so he counters the argument of enjoyment that is being brought about by Arjuna. And then the last segment, you have two more segments, right? So 39th to 53rd verse talks about Arjuna. Arjuna was worried about what? He was worried about sinful reactions, right? I don't want to kill them. If I'm going to kill them, I'm going to accrue sin. So why should I fight? Like that, Arjuna is saying, right? And for that, Krishna is going to talk about Nishkama Karma Yoga, which is you fight with detachment. Don't worry about the results. Then you're not going to get any sinful reactions. So this is the mood you have to fight, Arjuna. He will talk about Nishkama Karma Yoga in very depth. That is from verses 39 to 53. And then finally, he's going to talk about the characteristics of a Sitta Prajna. How would this person, Sitta Prajna, act? What are his behaviors? How would he eat, sleep, or walk for that matter? Can you please tell me? So he would elaborate on the characteristics of Sitta Prajna. So it's a beautiful section where we will be seeing about Arjuna's doubts and surrender. We are going to talk about all of his concerns being addressed by Krishna in this chapter. So it's very interesting that way. Mataji, are you able to share your screen now? One second.
I'm sharing, Mataji.
Great. Yes, I can see it, Mataji. All right. Thank you so much. So anybody wants to go ahead and read these verses, then we can try to contemplate and understand each verse at a time. Thank you. Whoever wants can go ahead.
Mataji, can I?
Yes, Aditya.
Okay, Sanjay Uvacha. This is the second chapter, right? Is it?
Correct. This is the second chapter, first verse.
Okay. Sanjay Uvacha, tamtata kripaya vishtam ashrupurna kulekshanam vishidantamidam vakyam kacha madhusudanah.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Should I say the translation too?
Translation and purport, yeah.
Okay. Sanjaya said, seeing Arjuna full of compassion, his mind depressed, his eyes full of tears, Madhusudana Krishna spoke the following words. And the purport is, material compassion, lamentation, and tears are all signs of ignorance of the real self. Mm-hmm. Compassion for the eternal soul is self-realization. The word Madhusudana is significant in this verse. Lord Krishna killed the demon Madhu, and now Arjuna wanted Krishna to kill the demon of misunderstanding that had overtaken him in the discharge of his duty. No one knows where compassion should be applied. Compassion for the dress of a drowning man is senseless. A man fallen in the ocean of nescience cannot be saved simply by rescuing his outward dress, the gross material body. One who does not know this and laments for the outward dress is called a Shudra, or one who laments unnecessarily. Arjuna was a Kshatriya, and this conduct was not expected from him. Lord Krishna, however, can dissipate the lamentation of the ignorant man, and for this purpose the Bhagavad Gita was sung by him. This chapter instructs us in self-realization by an analytical study of the material body and the spirit soul, as explained by the Supreme Authority, Lord Sri Krishna. This realization is possible when one works without attachment to fruitive results and is situated in the fixed conception of the real self.
Thank you so much, Aditya. That was so nice. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. So we will try to understand this verse. I don't have any fixed target for completing number of verses, but we will go slowly and steadily. That way we will be able to understand the essence of each of the verses. So this verse is very important because it's starting off and we need to understand the background. And I'll also tell about the Mahabharata stories as and when required. So that way we will be able to connect the dots and we will be able to get a holistic picture of Bhagavad Gita. Because this way you're able to understand philosophy and you're able to correlate what are the stories that are relevant to Mahabharata and what are some practical examples that we can see in our day-to-day life, which we can apply to this verse, right? So those are the things that we will be seeing. So as I told you, I don't have any specific target of number of verses to complete, but we will go slowly, if that's okay. Are you all okay with this approach? Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji.
Yes.
Okay. So as you can see, now Sanjaya, he is actually the one who is happened to say the story or narrate the story to Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra knew the mind of Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra, how is he? What kind of person he is? He's so attached to his sons. In fact, he knows, Dhritarashtra knows that Pandavas were righteous and virtuous and they deserve to be the rulers of the kingdom. But he still wants his sons, Kauravas, to emerge victorious. So at the end of the first chapter, Sanjaya described to Dhritarashtra how Arjuna, he happened to put down the weapons. He desired and he said, I desire to go on the path of nonviolence and I'm just going to keep my Gandiva bow aside and I'm not going to fight. This was what was the state of Arjuna when at the end of the first chapter, so as to speak. So now, looking at Dhritarashtra, what is his mood? He's so pleased. He's like, yeah, this is what I want. I don't want the Pandavas to fight. I still want Arjuna to continue this mentality of ahimsa paramo dharmo, right? He wants to be in the mode of nonviolence. And I want Arjuna to keep going in that route so that there will be no obstacle. And my sons will then be able to rule the kingdom without any problem. If Arjuna says I'm not going to fight, then obviously the kingdom is going to be with the Kauravas. They are going to enjoy. And this is what I want. This is the perspective of Dhritarashtra. And now Sanjaya, with his fine, obviously Sanjaya is very intelligent. He understood Dhritarashtra mentally. And immediately he wanted to dash his hopes. And he said, use this word by addressing Madhusudana. What does Madhusudana mean? This is very important for us to understand this term, Madhusudana.
Madhusudana means the killer of the Madhu demon.
Correct. Killer of the Madhu demon. And here in this context, Krishna, he's going to kill the demon of doubts that is arising in the mind of Arjuna. So Arjuna, we know the state of him. He doesn't want to fight. He says, I don't want to kill my relatives for so and so and so reason, right? He gives so four reasons so far and says, I don't want to fight. And he puts his Gandiva bow down. And now Sanjaya specifically uses this word Madhusudana because Krishna, he is going to now instruct Arjuna and kill all the doubts that are there in his mind. And that is why the specific use of the word Madhusudana is being used. And okay, so that is the scenario. And so he's now going to tell Dhritarashtra, so don't be under illusion or false hopes, thinking because Arjuna is lamenting in grief, he's going to give up the war and say, I'm not going to fight. He will soon come back. He's going to come back with fears and he's going to come back. Why he's going to come back? How do you know he's going to come back? Because we have Krishna. He's going to kill all the doubts of Arjuna. And this is the reason why he's going to come back. Like that, Sanjaya indirectly points to Dhritarashtra by using this word, Madhusudana. So now we can understand the purport even more. we understand that Arjuna is very keen on fighting till such a time actually he came face to face with the relatives, because he was put in the midst of the armies, and when he saw his relatives, he was not able to fight. His heart wavered and he wants to tell Krishna, you kill the demon of you kill the enemy demon, am I supposed to kill my relatives? It is a different story altogether, right, Krishna? You are killing your enemies. That is different from killing the relatives. It's not same. It's not a one-on-one match, right? Like that he wants to come forward and tell to Krishna, this is what is going on in my mind. Therefore, we can understand that he was put into illusion. Illusion was due to bodily identification. So what is bodily identification? We definitely have to understand what is illusion and what is this bodily identification. Because if we don't understand, then we are going to misplace our compassion. That is what Srila Prabhupada says. So we have to very carefully understand what is illusion and what is this bodily identification that Srila Prabhupada is talking about.
Mataji, is bodily identification like identifying oneself as your body, as your, that your body?
Correct. Exactly. You can identify yourself as the body. You can identify yourself with the mind. But at any point in time, you're not identifying. Correct. You're not identifying as the soul. Or meaning you're not identifying yourself as the eternal servant of the servant of the servant of Lord Krishna. So this is what is bodily identification. You're exactly on target. Very good. Okay. So now we'll understand more of what this bodily identification is. Okay. Like in a dream, we sometimes think that we have been chased by a tiger. We think our head has been cut off. It's a dream, okay? So you think so many things. Anything can happen in a dream, right? So the illusion is so powerful like a dream. Then we start crying in the dream. We start to lament. My head has gone. The tiger is chasing me. So this bodily lamentation or bodily attachment is such a kind of illusion, okay? All lamentation that happens is it's all because we are attached to our body. You know, that is the reason it is all happening. And we are suffering in this world because of our bodily misidentification. If we don't identify with ourselves with the body, then we will not suffer any longer. Arjuna, in this case, he is having this bodily identification. And because of that reason, if you look at his eyes, tears start pouring down from his eyes. He is a powerful warrior. He is the greatest warrior on the earth. But still, we see that he is crying and tears are flowing down from his eyes. All this is because of this bodily attachment, says Srila Prabhupada. So this is so powerful. And when we are stuck to this bodily identification, we don't know what we are doing. We may be ending up doing wrong things. That is what Srila Prabhupada eventually will come and tell us. Oh my God, because of this, you are putting yourself in so much distress, which is not worthy of. And we will be seeing more of that. And Sanjaya, he describes that Arjuna was overwhelmed with this compassion. He was feeling compassion for this, for compassion with his relatives. And he understood that I'm not going to kill my relatives. This was the state. Because of that compassion, he was not going to kill his relatives. And all this was happening because of this bodily attachment. And again, Srila Prabhupada here talks about compassion for the outward dress of the body. So in the material world, we have to know where we have to apply the compassion. What is true compassion? What does real compassion mean?
Mataji!
Yes. What is real compassion?
Real compassion is like going to your friends or whoever or whatever, and then telling them about Krishna, because then they can understand Krishna more and all that.
Correct. So when we are at the body, what is your question, Varun? I'm so sorry.
Yeah, no, I just have a comment.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that there's something that Arjuna doesn't understand when he says he doesn't want to kill the relatives. Mm-hmm. And that thing that he doesn't understand is that when he says you're gonna kill Krishna, he doesn't understand that you're really just killing killing the covering of your soul, and you're the soul and he's just killing the body.
Correct. Yes, absolutely. You're right on target. Yes, Krishna is going to talk about that very soon. He's going to come and say that, of course, you're not killing anything, because body as such is very temporary and eternal, and the soul is permanent. Absolutely, you're right on target, and we will be soon seeing that. And now we understand that Arjuna is put into bodily attachment and bodily illusion, and he's put it through illusion. Because of that, we are seeing that eyes, tears in his eyes, and all these symptoms are shown in him for that reason. And so in the material world, we need to know where compassion has to be applied to. And we will talk about some examples to make sure that we understand this concept very well. So Srila Prabhupada, he narrated a story in this connection. What was that story? He talked about one time a man was drowning in a river, and several people, they happened to gather onto the shore. And none of them knew how to swim. Finally, one of them, he knew how to swim, and he jumped into the river and he swam up to that man who was drowning. And then he came back and said, "I have saved him. I have saved him." And when the people saw that this man had saved, they saw that he only brought the coat. He had brought the coat of the man and saved and said, "I saved him. I saved him." And nobody said, You didn't save the man. You just brought the outward dress, and you're saying that this person is, you saved him. And so what's the value of your saving? What's the value of you jumping into the water? So Srila Prabhupada, he said that this body is like a dress or a coat. And obviously, this is just an outer covering. It is just for you. The soul is obviously in the body, and it's protected because of the body. But you're just, this person, who brought the coat, he just happened to protect the coat and not that person as such. So he, what's the use? There's no use. That is what Srila Prabhupada is trying to bring about through this example. And Atma is being covered by this dress of material body. In material consciousness, when we are devoid of spiritual knowledge, what happens? What happens when we don't have the spiritual knowledge, when we don't have the knowledge of the guru, sadhu, or shastras, then what happens? Then we actually apply our compassion to the body. That is what happens. When we have our spiritual knowledge, we will apply that in understanding our own self. So there is a contrast here, right? A person who is devoid of spiritual knowledge, he is not going to know about the soul. Then how can he be compassionate towards the soul? No, he cannot be, because he doesn't know the concept of the soul. On the contrary, if you look at a person who is very good in the spiritual knowledge, he knows the knowledge of the soul, and he can obviously be compassionate towards himself because he knows the concept of the soul. Are you all able to understand the difference between a person who lacks spiritual knowledge and as opposed to a person who has spiritual knowledge? This person who has only material knowledge will have only material compassion. On the contrary, this person who has the spiritual knowledge, he will have compassion towards the soul. And understanding this...
Wait, Mataji, I have a question.
Yes. Go ahead, Aditya.
Did Arjuna, like, since he had compassion for the people at that time, did he have only material compassion, or didn't he have spiritual compassion too? Because like,
very good
he question. Knew that Krishna was the supreme end.
Correct.
I'm pretty sure I have the answer to that.
Okay, go ahead, Varun, if you want
to. I'm pretty sure Arjuna, Krishna had just put all that stuff into Arjuna so that we would learn that we shouldn't have this bodily compassion and all that.
Correct. I mean, Aditya, your question is very valid. Your question is right on target. And to Varun's point, you're also right to say that obviously, Arjuna at this point, he's put into illusion by Krishna. He's a pure devotee of the Lord. But because we need to understand and get the information of Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna as a pure devotee was put into illusion temporarily for some time so that we can understand what this is all about. What is real compassion? What is material compassion? And Varun, one point is that we don't say you should avoid material compassion. No, we are not saying that. It should not just be material compassion. You should also be compassionate towards your soul. That is what Srila Prabhupada is saying. Okay, so what am I supposed to do? If I am seeing a hungry person on the streets, am I not supposed to help him, give him prasad? Yes, You are giving him prasad. In that way, you are taking care of not only his bodily hunger, but also you are helping him to be promoted and get into devotional service. It can be a beginning for his devotional service since you are giving him prasadam. So you're doing some act of compassion on the material platform too for a person who sees you are trying to help him. We can understand that he's being fed bodily, and because of that, his hunger would go. That person, he may not even have spiritual knowledge. So he may not even know this is prasadam, right? And that he's going to begin his devotional service. So you're taking care of both the scenarios there. This is what is compassion according to Srila Prabhupada, that is understanding your own self, self-realization. It is spiritual. I mean, that is where the spiritual knowledge comes into play. And that is what is real compassion. So Arjuna here, he is misplacing his compassion. That is what Krishna is saying.
Mataji, also material compassion automatically comes when you do devotional service, right?
Yes, yes. Obviously, you will be compassionate towards them, but you will always be looking at it from a spiritual point of time. I mean, spiritual point. I mean, because say, for example, you are coming across a person who wants to misuse his money. You're not going to give charity to that kind of person. You will be careful, right? But instead, you will be donating it to all ISKCON facilities because they are appropriately using the funds in a very good manner for devotional service. So that is where your compassion will go to, right? Not to this person who may want to buy some tobacco or be involved in some sinful activity. It could be anything. But we should not misplace our compassion. That is the essence of this verse. So the misplaced compassion will create difficulty and it is going to implicate some actions and reactions. So if you're going to misplace your compassion, Krishna says that it is going to obviously get you into trouble. So better don't do it. So people, they understand the implications of showing compassion to others because they don't know what is real compassion. And Varun pointed out, the compassion for the external soul is self-realization. And that is what Srila Prabhupada wants us. The real compassion is that we have to be compassionate towards understanding of the soul, understanding the true self, understanding the Atma. And this way, we show compassion to ourselves. So when we are chanting, what do we do? We are being compassionate to ourselves. Because we know the main cause of suffering in this world is forgetfulness of Krishna. And when that ignorance is taken out and when that ignorance goes away, then what will happen? Your suffering is going to go away. Aren't you compassionate towards yourself by chanting the Maha Mantra? That is what Krishna is deriving at the end of the day. He wants you to understand, show compassion to yourself and others by knowing about Atma, by realizing the Atma, by bringing the connection of Atma and Paramatma, and then giving pleasure to the slowly. He's going to introduce these concepts. He's going to first talk about Atma, as I told you. Then he's going to talk about the detachment or the Nishkama Karma. Like that, he's slowly going to build up and talk about these various concepts so that Arjuna is clear in his mind, because right now he is under illusion. He is under the bodily concept of life on the bodily attachment platform. And Krishna, he is going to slowly and steadily make him understand what. So now he has made him understand what is compassion. So there is no one. I mean, obviously, we just have to make sense with this. And Srila Prabhupada here talks about a learned person. He doesn't lament unnecessarily for something that is temporary. He also brings up that point and he says that, you know, the learned person, he doesn't do that. So now, Krishna, he's being addressed as Madhusudana, right? I'm going to destroy. And Krishna, he says, I'm going to destroy this demon of forgetfulness. That is forgetfulness of what? What? Forgetfulness of one's own identity. Now this person Arjuna, he forgets his own identity and he's posing me this question because he doesn't know what the spirit soul means. And so that way I need to educate this devotee, right? And help him come out of this forgetfulness. And I have to save him because he is now being attacked by illusion. And now Krishna, he is going to reprimand Arjuna, and he is going to give some concepts and advices to Arjuna. He's going to give a pep talk, we would say. I mean, and what is that pep talk going to be? We will see in the next verse. So can somebody go to the next verse? Are you all clear with this first verse?
Yes,
first
verse? I understand it.
Okay. Okay. Are you all clear with the first verse before we move on to the second verse? I don't know how it works. Yeah, go ahead.
Hare Krishna. Constructing the hospitals and those things for charity, they will come at the body level, Mataji, but they will really help the society. So how can we understand, is it good or how can we understand that?
Yes, Prabhu. So from a devotee's perspective, say for example, there are three modes which we operate, right? I mean, mode of ignorance, mode of passion, mode of goodness, and mode of you transcend the modes. That is Suddha Sattva. So in the mode of goodness, I mean, in the mode of ignorance, you don't know what you're doing, and you could have misplaced compassion. You could give donations anywhere. That is mode of ignorance. And in the mode of passion, you do it for name and fame. And that is the mood in which you give charity. And in the mode of goodness, you do have compassion, but it is acting on the mode of goodness, like charity to the hospitals. You don't want name or fame or anything of that sort. But at the end of the day, all you want, I mean, you just expect something good out of it. That's all. You don't have any expectations on that. So this comes under the mode of goodness. And when you want to go above these modes, then that is where the concept of soul comes in. You're looking at the cause of suffering, the root cause of suffering. The root cause of suffering is forgetfulness of Krishna. And when we are tackling that problem there, then all other problems, they become insignificant. So this person who's in the hospital or anything for that matter, when he understands the concept of soul, then his life is going to become much more happier than before. Because in the goodness, even if he doesn't know or if he doesn't have any knowledge spiritually, then his life is of no use. So this person who's above these modes, he always thinks of it from that perspective. How can I give this person permanent happiness? The permanent happiness can come only through the process of devotional service. And that is they all, as I told you, it acts according to the modes. You give charity based on the modes and based on what you want out of it.
Yeah. In
the mode of goodness, you're acting on the I platform, me and mine. If you look at it from that perspective, I get happiness out of it at the end of the day, right? That is your motive. When you do this, when I'm going to give the charity to say big hospital, I feel happy by doing it. So it's coming across as a me and my thing. But when you transcend the modes, you're looking at it for Krishna's pleasure, for pleasure of Krishna. Because when the soul, when he revives his relationship with Krishna, then it gives pleasure to Krishna. So you're looking at it above that level, above the concept of me and mine. Are you clear, Prabhu?
Yes, Mataji. Yes, Mataji. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Hare Krishna. Okay, can we move on to this verse? I don't know. So does this class end in another 8 minutes? Is that how it works? Hare Krishna. So we have, we are at 6:30 here in the PST, which is 9:30 for you, right? I mean, 8 more minutes.
8:30 to 9:30, Mataji. Yes.
Okay. So can we complete the second verse and maybe call it off? I mean, sure. Is that okay? Or do you want to stop? I don't know. I mean, up to you. Can we go on to the second verse?
Sure, Mataji. I think I'm good. We can go. But I don't know how long it will take. And then after that, we will go for question and answers.
Okay, so any Lakshmi Mataji and others, anybody have any inputs as to do we want to do the second verse or how do you think in terms of time?
Well, Mataji, if we do the second verse, then also do the question and answer session, that will take a long time.
I think, I mean, in terms of question and answers on verse one, do we have any questions before we move on? If you don't have questions, then we can go on to the second verse.
Yes, Mataji, we can go on to the second verse.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you so much. Okay, somebody can you just please read the second verse? Yes, go ahead. Varun.
Okay. Shri Bhagavan Vacha Kutastam Kashma Namidam Prabhavam Vyapra Mochet Vishame Samavasantam Anaya Jostam Asa Asvardhyam Akhiya Tekaram Arjuna.
So can I read the translation? Yes, yes. I think it's a big translation. You don't, I mean, purport seems big, right, Lakshmi Mataji?
Yes, it's a big purport.
Okay, so I will tell you the purport in essence. Just read the translation alone. Let's not spend time on the purport, if that's okay.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, "My dear Arjuna, now how have these impurities come upon you? They are not benefiting a man who knows the value of life. They lead to higher planets, but to infamy."
Yes, yes, very good. Thank you so much. I appreciate it, Varun. Really appreciate it. So the essence of this verse, right? I mean, obviously, this is a big, long purport. We will try to see, I'll just try to stick to the time. But maybe if I'm not able to complete the whole thing, we can take it to the next class. That way, you're understanding this purport in essence. My point is that if we rush, we may not be able to understand the concepts. And that is the reason I'm taking it slow. We can definitely go through it fast if that's what you want. I don't know what is the motive here. Is the space okay?
Yes, Mataji, you can go as per your speed. We can understand it clearly.
Okay, sounds good. So now here, Krishna, he tells Arjuna that, his good arguments, it's all the arguments that is coming out of Arjuna are anarya jushtam, meaning it's not befitting an Aryan. And Arjuna's impurities, it will not lead him to Swarga, that is Asavargyam, and it will only cause him infamy, that is Akirtikaram. In other words, Arjuna will become infamous in the present, and at death he will not be awarded any residence in the higher planets. So therefore, Krishna, he doesn't approve of this Arjuna's compassion. So this is the essence or gist of what Srila Prabhupada is trying to say. So one is that Arjuna's impurities would not lead him to, I mean, it is first of all not befitting an Arya. And what is the term Arya is something we will see now. And Arjuna's impurity, what is it? It is not going to lead him to Swarga, that is Asavargyam. And then it will cause him only Akirtikaram, infamy. And then Arjuna, he will become, as a result, what will happen at the present and after death? We have to look at two things. At the present, what will happen? It is going to give him infamy. And what will happen to him after death? It is not going to lead him to higher planets. So Krishna is not approving of whatever Arjuna's compassion is. So this is the essence. So we will dig in deeper and try to understand the purport of Srila Prabhupada and what he tries to tell us. And what are some practical lessons and implications that we'd have to follow with regards to this verse. That is going to be the mode of approach. Okay. One second. I'm just opening the Vedabhyas. Yeah. So in the verse, I mean, Mataji, can you share the verse? One second. Okay, great. So as you all can see there, the first line, what does it say in the first verse? I mean, in the second verse, the first line, what does it say? Sri Bhagavan Vacha. So Sanjaya, he is introducing the speaker, Lord Krishna, to Dhritarashtra. And what is he saying? He is saying, Krishna, he is Bhagavan, right? And we all know Bhagavan, as per Parasara Muni, he is the one who has six kinds of opulences. And what are the six? Wealth, power, fame, beauty, knowledge, and renunciation. And these qualities, they are found in perfection in Lord Krishna. And one may say, what do you mean? I also have this quality. I also have fame. I'm also famous. I'm also beautiful. I also have knowledge. What do you mean? You say only Krishna has these qualities? No, I can't agree to that. And for that, Srila Prabhupada says, we have it in very, very minute quantities. We are all living beings created by Lord Krishna, and we are part and parcels of Lord Krishna. We are the fragmental parts of Lord Krishna. And Krishna, he has these in perfection, and he has got these qualities unlimitedly. And he's got these in perfection. How about us? We only have teeny tiny bit of this quality. So you can imagine how much, say, for example, we say, okay, who's the present guy who's very famous? Is it the Tesla owner? I don't know. Kids, you might know whatever his name is, right? I mean, he can be famous, but Elon Musk. Yeah. Okay. Yes. So we may think he is famous, but Krishna, this Bhagavad Gita has been spoken many years ago, and Krishna, we all know him since ages.
Mataji, you forgot Jeff Bezos.
Okay, say Jeff Bezos, right? We all could think that they're all famous personalities, but Krishna, he is famous than the famous. He's got this in perfection, and nobody can beat Krishna. That is the point I'm driving at. And nowadays, we see that this term Bhagavan is being misused by a lot of followers. I mean, Srila Prabhupada, he was always very cautious when some of his new devotees, when they would come to him and, you know, obviously due to their ignorance, they would think that he is Lord and they would call him Bhagavan. And he wouldn't definitely encourage that, and he would immediately condemn them and prohibit them from doing such things. And hence the term Bhagavan was very carefully used by Srila Prabhupada, and he always wanted to differentiate and understand the disciples to know who's Bhagavan and who's Guru and what his mission is and what are the qualities of, we are all part and parcel. So he always stresses this in all of the classes. But then, obviously, in the day-to-day scenario, because of this Kali Yuga getting corrupted so much, people address themselves as Bhagavan, and when their followers do so, they happily accept that and they move on with it. You know, these are all condemned, and obviously, we should not encourage such acts. And if you consider Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, for that instance, he incarnated 500 years ago, and he was playing a part of a devotee. And if you look at him, even though he is Lord himself, when somebody would come to him and address him as God, he would close his ears and he will say, Vishnu, Vishnu, don't commit such offense. Don't commit such blasphemy. I'm just a simple devotee of the Lord, because he was playing the part of the Lord. That is the mood. That is the mood he was operating on. And so therefore, we should be careful about the usage of the word Bhagavan, which is what is being stressed by Srila Prabhupada always. So he always says that it is said that the problem today is that people are propagating this kind of view, and that is why there is so much confusion. People don't understand who Krishna is. And anyone who has got a little bit of power, they just address them as Bhagavan. And Bhagavan is not such a term to be used. Bhagavan is Krishna. Krishna is the absolute God, and nobody can equal to him in any of these opulences. And he is Bhagavan. And obviously, there is also a distinction that he brings about. He says, we all have these demigods, right? The demigods, Indra, Varuna, all these are posts that are given to these demigods. But if you look at it in contrast, Bhagavan is not a post. Bhagavan is Bhagavan. He's Bhagavan eternally. It's not some kind of a post that is assigned to a demigod. So that is the difference. It is eternal situation. Krishna is eternally Bhagavan. So Sanjaya, he wants to make it clear right from the beginning. And he uses this word, Sri Bhagavan Vacha. Krishna, he is the source of all the devatas. And Krishna, he is the originator. He is the cause of all causes. So Sanjaya wants to make this clear, okay? And now we will see what is this Arya? What does this Arya mean? Arya means the person who knows about the spiritual purpose of life. One who knows spiritual values of life is an Arya. And Arjuna is behaving in such a situation that he is unbecoming of an Arya. It will not take you to the auspicious destination. It will make you infamous. You will become, you will lose all your fame. It doesn't befit an Arya. So he's, as we see, it's not worthy of you. What you're doing, I mean, because you're an Arya, you have to have the spiritual knowledge and the goal of life. All these, whatever you're doing, this is not at all befitting what an Aryan would do. So it's neither going to give happiness or fame in this life, or it is even in after death, it is not get, going to get you into the right destination. So what's the point, Arjuna? What is the point of you doing this? Whatever you're doing, this is not right. And there is an example that is being quoted, right? I mean, just for you to understand. Say, for example, do you all like cricket? If that's the...
Yeah.
Okay, you like cricket, so you can relate it to that event. Say, for example, there is a World Cup match that is happening. And the bowler, he has to bowl. And he has to put a sixer in this particular over. That is the last ball. And at that time, if he's saying, oh, I'm very nervous. I'm very scared. I'm not going to do this act. And he's getting nervous. And now this captain, he's coming and saying him, why are you choking up like this? You know, this is the time you have to show your real caliber. This is the time you have to play very nicely, boldly, and you have to act like a man, right? And you're just behaving like a choker. What is this? This is not right. And the same way, Krishna, he's telling Arjuna, don't choke up. This is a crisis moment. This is a pressure moment. This is the time the real stuff has to come out. You have to be really strong. This is not unbecoming of you, of an Aryan. This is not what an Aryan is supposed to do. This is not befitting you by any means. So you're not supposed to do this kind of act. The crisis moment, you have to fight and be bold and be courageous, and you have to do the needful. Instead, you can't say, I'm going to run away, right? And this is the advice Krishna is actually giving to Arjuna in this scenario. So this is the essence of the second verse. And obviously, there are three, I mean, if you look at the purport, I mean, three things are talked about, right? We know Bhagavan realization, Brahman realization, and Paramatma realization. So Brahman is the effulgence of the Lord, and Paramatma is the localized aspect, understanding the Paramatma in your heart, that is the Shiro Daksha Vishnu, and Bhagavan, he is the Supreme Personality of the Godhead. So with regards to this, understanding the Brahman aspect helps you to understand the eternity. Paramatma aspect helps you to understand the eternity in knowledge. And Bhagavan, when you realize the Bhagavan feature, you realize the two other features also. You realize the Brahman and Paramatma feature. It is Sachit Ananta. That is the eternity, knowledge, and bliss. So this is what it is essentially driving to. Yes. So with this, I can conclude today's session. And maybe we can take up any questions, and then after that we can adjourn. Varun, your question is...
Wait, Mataji, what's the exact definition of an Aryan again?
Aryan is the one who knows the spiritual goal or spiritual purpose to life.
Oh, so Arjuna was an Aryan, except like when he was acting like this, Krishna said that his qualities were not befitting of someone
Correct.
Who was an Aryan?
Correct. Exactly.
Okay.
Yes. Thank you, Aditya. That was good attentive listening. Hare Krishna.
Mataji, wonderful, wonderful class. Thank you so much. It's such a beautiful, even listening to you when you summarize our Bhagavad Gita reading, it's so good. That's 5-10 minutes. This is such a nice flow of understanding and explaining each and every point thoroughly. Very, very nice, Mataji. It's such a, it's so nectarian to hear from you.
Thank you, Mataji, for the opportunity. All because of you and Sukhasagari, Mataji, I'm here. Totally indebted to you for your association and helping me to spread the glories of Bhagavad Gita and Srila Prabhupada through this process. I am totally indebted to you and thankful for you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
Hare Krishna Lakshmi Mataji.
Thank you very much, Mataji. Such a wonderful class. Mataji, I have a few questions regarding the first Gita Mahatmya. At the end of the conclusion, that was the Parashruti of that chapter 2 verses. You said that the tiger, which is used to, normally it is used to kill the goat. Mm-hmm. And the goat is, which used to be fearful on the tiger. So you said there was a change in their natural, bodily nature was changed.
Mm.
So is that what we get from the Gita Mahatmya, that our self is being coming out, or like how do we understand?
Correct, Mataji. So the main thing that we need to understand is that our consciousness shifts, and our the way through which we look at things change. Once we understand and get the spiritual knowledge, and once we understand the devotion to Lord Krishna, then whatever our mood was before, our consciousness was before, it will change, and all our acts will be now to please Krishna. So that will be the goal or the end result.
So in that case, Mataji, if you see, that is called the self-realization, which the yogis, they do, they go to the mountains or they go to a secluded place and they do meditation and tapas for so many years to get this self-realization. So here the tiger or the goat or the Mitravan, they did not undergo any tapasya. So the same...
No, the Mitravan did.
After they're reciting the verses daily, but again they're sitting and meditating.
No, Mataji, he's also into the Ashtanga yoga process. He was initiated through the yogi who was sitting in the cross-legged position. So he did get through him he got the knowledge and he started to practice. Even when Devashyama happened to come to him, he was in the meditation only, in the Ashtanga yoga process only.
So he has become a yogi, and also reciting the chapter 2, and that gives shift in your consciousness. That is
devotion to Lord Krishna.
Okay, so that is the Palashruti, that we keep reciting the chapter 2, we get the self-realization and we get a consciousness shift towards Krishna.
So the thing is, Mataji, one is theoretical understanding, another is the realization. Meaning we understand the essence and try to apply it in our lives. And for that, certain scenarios will happen in our life, which will enable us to apply these things practically. So when we start to do that, then we have realized knowledge. So right now, this is not easy, because we are always put into bodily identification at all points in time, because of which we react in a certain way. And for this to go, this theoretical knowledge have to become practical, realized knowledge. And only then we will be able to get the fruits or devotion. It's not like very easy. What I try to say is that this process of devotional service takes a long time. And we have to be patient and we have to go in the right. And when Krishna, through his mercy, when he gives that devotion and when he is pleased with us, he will shower his mercy on us. And that time we become realized. Till that time, we have to wait. It is a slow process.
Okay, Mari. So that's where the meditation of Mitravan comes in. He understands it, he realizes it, and they go through it. Yes. Yeah, thank you, Mataji.
And that is the state he attained. He is peaceful. Who can be peaceful? Only when you are peaceful, you can share the peace with others. Only when you are compassionate, only when you have that satisfaction, you will be able to give satisfaction to others. So what you have is what you give.
Yes, yes. Okay, Mataji, that's clear. Mm-hmm. And regarding that, the topic says it is contents of Gita summarized, Mataji.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, how do I understand the entire Gita? It has 18 chapters. Mm. That's the entire Gita. But this topic is saying the contents of Gita is summarized.
Mm. So, as I told you, I gave you the gist, right? What we are going to see. So, it is going to cover all the aspects in a very condensed form. So we are going to know about Atma, we are going to know about Karma Yoga, we are going to know about a Stitha Prajna, self-realized person. In this way, a condensed form of Gita is presented to you in the second chapter.
So basically, when Krishna was telling the second chapter to Arjun, actually the entire Gita he summarized and he said it. Then again, he gave the elaborate explanation in the coming chapters.
Correct. This is going to give you a preview, and then we are going to see obviously the details, because each and every chapter is a nectar in itself. So obviously Krishna, he wants to share more with us, because we have varied kinds of people on varied platforms, and not everybody is in the Bhakti Yoga platform. Somebody could be an Ashtanga Yogi, somebody could be a Karma Yogi, somebody could be a Jnana Yogi. So to address everybody, we have these different yogas, and ultimately Srila Prabhupada will say that Bhakti Yoga is the culmination of all the yoga. Meaning, if you do Bhakti Yoga, there is no need for doing any other yoga. It covers everything, basically.
Okay, Mataji, thank you. And one last question, and sorry if the question is wrong, I'm just trying to understand.
No questions are wrong, Mataji. Please go ahead.
So at the end of the first chapter, when Suga Sagri Mataji summarized the first chapter, she like ended the class with saying that all these qualities that we see in Arjuna, which the four questions that he raised and the symptoms that he undergoes, these were the qualities of a devotee, because he was qualified to get the enlightenment or the knowledge from Lord Krishna. So that was the end of the first chapter conclusion we were discussing. So right now, in this particular verse, Krishna is saying it as kashmala, dirties or impurities. So like, how do you know these are the qualities of a Vaishnava? So I'm trying to understand, is this, as you said in the cricket, on the stage where you are to perform, there if you say I'm not going to perform, is it an impurity? Or how do I understand?
So this is the essence, right, Mataji? In the sense, Krishna, he's going to counteract, and he's going to say, what are all the things, I mean, say for example, so first is Arjuna's compassion, right? So he has actually misplaced his compassion. He's showing compassion to the bodily platform. He's showing compassion to on a bodily platform. And so he gives knowledge about soul. He says that soul is eternal and it is not a temporary like a body. So compassion on the soul. And that is what is going to be discussed in 11th to 30th verses. And then we are going to see about, he says enjoyment, right? How am I supposed to enjoy when everybody dies? I'm not going to enjoy. So he's talking about enjoyment that is also on the material platform. And so he's going to say, see, by doing your prescribed duty, you're going to actually enjoy. So that is the essence of 31 to 38. And then we are going to see Krishna is further going to counteract and say, oh, Krishna is saying, Arjuna is saying, I'm going to get all sins. I'm not going to do this act of killing people. Only if you're not performing the instructions of Lord Krishna, you're going to accrue sin. Krishna is right there in front of you. You're forgetting Krishna. You're forgetting about Krishna. And you're not trying to please Krishna. So work in a detached fashion. You do your duty. So he said in 31 to 38, do your prescribed duty. And 39 to 53, he's going to talk about and say, fight with detachment. And to please Krishna will ultimately become the goal eventually. And then he's going to talk about characteristics of a self-realized person, how a self-realized person, how will he act and how will he work with through his senses, mind and intelligence? What are his characteristics? So he's going to give us little by little knowledge of helping us to understand why Arjuna was wrong because of him misplacing his compassion, or because of him considering his enjoyment to be enjoyment with relatives, but actual enjoyment is performing the duties. And then third thing is sin by, I mean, he's actually performing sin by not obeying to what Krishna says. That is the sin. And that Krishna here, he's going to talk about Nishkama Karma Yoga and fighting with detachment. So this is a sequence that Krishna is going to go through. I mean, whatever Arjuna is doing, I mean, as I told you, he's been got into this illusion by Krishna just for us to help us understand how should a devotee act, or what is Krishna's expectations of a devotee, and where should he place his compassion, and what should he do, how should he work, and so on and so forth.
Okay, Mataji, so now I'm trying to understand. So whatever Arjun said was Krishna is going to give him the real meaning of it.
Correct.
Like when we say you have to be compassionate on others, Prabhupada at the end in the purport he was telling what is a real compassion is. So like in the real way, they say you love others, but now the meaning of love is different. They don't understand the real meaning of love. They are an illusion. So same way, Krishna is going to clarify the real qualities that Arjun expressed, the real meaning of all those qualities.
Okay.
Exactly. That makes it clear, Mataji. Okay, Mataji, thank you so much. Such a wonderful class. And thank you very much for all your hard work and giving us a good lesson. Jai Sahanandana, Hare Krishna.
Wonderful. Thank you all so much. Any more questions anybody has? Hare Krishna. All of you all clear?
Thank you so much. Thank
you so much. Venkat Prabhu, are you good? Are you clear?
Yes. Thank you so much.
Great. Okay, devotees. So next class, I think, will be taught by Lalitangi Mataji or Sukhasagari Mataji. So we will continue off from where we left, and that is the sequence we'll be going through. So hope to all see you whenever my turn comes. I will definitely try to take up the verse, and we all can try to enjoy what Krishna has to say. So thank you so much. Really loved the interaction and interactive question and answer sessions as always. And obviously looking forward to serving you all soon. And all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Vancha kalpatarubhyascha kripa sindubhyeva cha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namah. Ananta koti vaishnav vrinda ki jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. And Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Hare Krishna to all dear devotees. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna Mataji, dandat pranam.
Dandat pranam. Such a beautiful.
Radhika Kasturi Mataji ki jai. Hare
Krishna. Thank you, Sukhasari Mataji. Hare Krishna. Thank you, Lalitangi Mataji.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.